Okay, what I should have said was this is the fanzine, quote, workshop, unquote. Now, obviously, the word workshop brings to mind the idea of actually publishing a fanzine. And with so many people in such a small area, that's impossible. So what we're going to do is have a fanzine panel. Yay. Yeah. Okay. My name is Linda Bushager, and I publish several fanzines, including Carass, which is a news zine, and Grand Falloon, which is a general fanzine. And to my right, I have...
What's his name?
some wonderful experts, including Gary Farber, who publishes numerous fanzines, including Fanastorica, Victoria Vane, who publishes...
Simulacrum.
Patrick Hayden, who publishes Moshe Feder, who used to publish Placebo.
That's a low cut.
And John Singer, who is an expert on gestetners and mimeographs. Carol Wayne McDonald, who is a fan artist extraordinaire, and if any of you are new to fandom, I highly recommend that you go to the Neo Fans room and purchase a copy of Bob Tucker's The Neo Fans Guide, and it's beautifully illustrated. Thank you very much, because I was going to quote for this from this and have it. And the cover, which is not nearly as nice as it should have been, because it was really a beautiful drawing, and somehow the offset process did not capture it.
Too black.
It was done by Terrell. But it's still good, but it's too black.
Can you hold it up and still?
It doesn't show the
detail.
Fine detail.
Should have linked your stencil to Terrell.
Yeah.
Well, I'm showing it to him first, then I'll show it to him. Okay. It's a cost a quarter, and it tells all about the history of fandom and some of the fanish slang words. And it's really good, and I highly recommend it. And it was just revised by Bob Tucker. Now, first of all, I'd like to know from you, how many of you do not know what a fanzine is? Let's try that. Yay, everybody knows what a fanzine is. How many of you have never published a fanzine? Not too many, okay? Of those of you who never published a fanzine, how many of you are interested in never publishing a fanzine? So you're all interested in publishing fanzines. Okay, that's a good start. I'm sorry that this panel started late. As you found, almost everything here starts late.
That's called Real Soon Now.
Real Soon Now. The reason for this is because I'm one of the people in charge of the bullsheet, along with Jeff May, and as you may have noticed, it hasn't come out yet. The reason is that the mimeograph has just broken down. And you see there a sheet, if you'll hold that up, please. One side of which is blank, a terrible waste of paper, and the reason is we got half through the first page and the mimeograph broke, the band broke, and we just got the repairman in, so they're working on it. So hopefully by the end of the day, sometime, we will have a complete two-sided sheet of news about the convention with all sorts of information, which is probably too late to help you.
Of course.
Now, this is a very impromptu panel because I have not talked to any of my panelists about what they're going to say or do or what we're going to do. And in fact, I do not know what we're going to do.
Yay.
So I'm going to have most of this panel be concerned with answering your questions. And what I'd like to get into is some detail on how to publish a fanzine, hints on how to get material, and...
don't forget Mimeo, you know.
Yeah.
And, how to publish a fanzine on a mimeograph. I assume that you would know that.
This will take a lot of imagination.
Never done a Mimeo fanzine in my life. That's why I'm here.
Well, that's what we'll show you a few things. Now, there is a mimeograph down in the bullsheet room, but since it was broken, I couldn't bring it to show you what a mimeograph looks like.
We can show you what it looks like. We can show it looks
John,
like.
Get up and imitate a mimeograph for it.
Actually, if they'd have brought the busted one, I would have made a valiant effort to
what?
Fix it. But
well, I think we can do it if we have just super strong glue, basically.
That won't quite do. No, the beer can is much bigger than the Mimeo.
Well, if you'll imagine John on top of the table, sort of hunched up and forming a square shape with his arms hanging off the side.
Let's do it. Let's do it.
Now, here's the crank.
plenty of craft.
And John, this is your best dramatic presentation.
Next
now
movie,
you know why
Ditto.
Yeah, now you know why Ditto is so popular. Yes.
Next movie, Joe Haldeman's Lime Jello and Demonstrate Hecto.
Now on Linda Bushinger to get up on the table and imitate Mimeo Inc.
Okay. Now, I passed around a number of fanzines, and the basic idea of this is not to plug my own fanzine, believe it or not, but just to show you what a mimeograph fanzine looks like. And since I published a mimeograph fanzine and they were handy, they're there. And if you'll notice, the repro or reproduction is pretty good on these. And if you compare it to anything done by offset, it's not bad. And there are various colored inks and so on.
I think the best way to put that is that good Mimeo is better than poor offset in every time.
Good anything is better than bad anything. Now, I'd like to pass the stencil down to Moshe and have him tell you about how to type a stencil.
Oh, gee.
The Moshe's imitation of the typewriter.
No doubt.
Moshe,
talk
well.
Well, they all said they were interested in
Mimeo. No doubt the reason Linda asks me to explain this to you is that I've just been typing the stencils for my fanzine, which in typical Fanish fashion hasn't been out in 4 years. But it's really very hard. Now, most stencils have two or three parts. The key part is this blue sheet. It occasionally comes in other colors, but this is the key part. This is a tissue impregnated with a wax-like substance. When the typefaces of your typewriter hit the wax-like substance, it pushes. Thank you. It pushes the wax aside in the shape of the letter on the typeface, and that produces the hole through which the ink can pass. The tissue is very porous, and the ink can pass through it very, very easily. When the wax, well, if I face that way, it's going to look ridiculous. When the wax is pushed aside. Now, this is the backing sheet here, and this comes into play later on because it produces the first proof copy of your image after you're ready to run your stencil off. On the front, on a good stencil, cheap stencils often come without them, is a sheet of plastic, usually called plyofilm. This protects the typeface keys and prevents them from getting all crudded up with bits of collected wax from the stencil sheet itself. Now, the idea here is to get as sharp an impression as possible without, at the same time, making it so sharp that the letters cut the stencil apart. It's a very well-known problem with blacked out O's, cut out O's. You want to avoid that. Now, the plastic sheet helps to some extent. The rest of it is just adjusting your typewriter properly, or if you have a manual, learning not to hit too hard on some of the letters so that you don't cut all the way through. Now, these are two other important elements. This is a stencil carbon. It's roughly similar to an ordinary carbon, because the carbon is white. And it's placed shiny side up between the backing sheet and the blue sheet, like this. And what happens is, when you type on the stencil, you're typing on the front here, the white carbon shows through the holes you've typed, makes it much more readily visible. Now the other part is this is a typing plate. They often come somewhat heavier than this. These add to make your type image of each letter sharper. This is sort of an optional thing. Depends on the kind of typeface you're using and the typewriter you've got.
They're a lot better when you use it, man.
Some people prefer a heavier imprint, a wider letter, and you can get that if you don't use this. So that's something you've got to experiment with and see what you like. But that's the basic thing to typing a stencil. And of course, something that happens when you're typing, no matter what you're typing, is the typos, since none of us are absolutely perfect typists, at least of all me. And the solution to this is to use correction fluid, better known as Corflu.
I didn't bring a bottle.
Do you have a bottle
with
of Corflu?
It's blue. It looks a little like this, except it's blue. Normally.
Or if it's Canadian
liquid. Now, if you pass
color.
That down, I'd like to demonstrate how to correct. It's amazing how many people do not know how to correct a stencil. Okay, normally a stencil with this cover sheet, film sheet, plyofilm, as they call it, is not connected at the top. It's normally hooked over or loosely connected so that as it's in the machine, you can lift it down. Okay, once you lift it down and you want to correct a mistake. Now, some people, what they do is, if this were correction fluid and there was a mistake, they just plop it on there. But if you do that, it sticks. And as you lift it up, the hole is ripped open again. So what you have to do is lift up your stencil, wipe it out with the correction fluid, let it dry. It takes about
half a minute.
Not even that long, 10 seconds. You can blow on it to dry it quicker. As soon as you see that it seems to be dry, just let it go back down, lift your film back up, and continue typing.
Mm. And you should note that when you retype the correction, you shouldn't hit it again quite so hard, because areas of the stencil that have been hit by the correction fluid are softer, and an impression made in them will always be wider or blacker when it's printed. So you should take that into account.
This is stencilment. Now, some people have also recommended taking a stylus,
right,
which has a flat, rounded head of some sort, or
up
some other object, I don't know, an ash, anything.
Paperclip, maybe.
Yeah.
Paperclip, something with a rounded edge, and smoothing out your mistake first, and then correcting it. I never do that, however. Now,
I can tell.
John has a few comments to add on typing stencils.
Yeah, first off, on correcting, what I usually do to hold the stencil away from the backing sheet is I just stick the handle of a stylus in, maybe two lines below the error, and it just holds it, and then I dab the cork on it. As far as typing them, I think people owning Selectrics, that's becoming more and more common, and you should know that the typeface on an IBM Selectric does not come to a point. Your ordinary typewriter typeface is a knife edge, okay? The Selectric has a plateau typeface. It cannot chop out letters. It does not ever require a cushion sheet unless you really want a heavy imprint. And instead, what we usually do is we put a typing plate in there, and that keeps it pretty crisp. So between the stencil and the backing sheet, you insert the typing plate, and they'll usually say, use this side only, so you know which side to put in forward. And you definitely want to apply a film if you're going to put a stencil into a Selectric, because otherwise, the little typing element gets full of wax, and that's, you just don't want to do that to your Selectric. They're too expensive to repair.
Too much trouble. You don't want to do that to any typewriter.
Question?
I had a comment. The ones that come with the plyo film attached to the stencil are usually quite expensive, but the Stettner sells a pack of 25 separate plyo films for $1, and they tell you you can only use them once, but I've used them up to 6 times before they fall apart.
I've used them about
definitely not true that you can only use them once, especially if you have something like a Selectric.
And AB Dick also sells them, and I wanted to point
out, usability goes down, but it's still readable.
Yeah. And if you want to improvise, I know a friend at least who uses the plastic off of wrapping underwear. And he just sticks it on and uses any kind of plastic.
Handy wrap doesn't work very well. It's too stiff.
It's too thick, yeah.
Now, I want to point out one thing is if you're just starting out and you have bought a mimeograph, you can always go to your mimeograph supplier. In fact, even if you probably don't own a mimeograph but are just buying supplies from them, you can always go to them and ask them what you're doing wrong. If you notice that you're under-inking, if your print just doesn't look right, ask them what you're doing wrong and they'll explain it. And A.B. Dick publishes a book called Techniques of Mimeography.
Very good book.
Very good book that has a lot of tips. And you can also ask other people what you're doing wrong. Show them your fanzine and they may be able to help you.
You've
got a question, maybe.
Okay.
Yeah, I just wanted to make the comment that it's not advisable if you're running very low on core flow or it's dried out to try to dilute it in order to stretch it with rubbing alcohol. I tried that. I had a whole fanzine full of crossover types.
Right. I can tell you how to dilute core flow. You dilute core flu with a mixture containing approximately 75% ether and 25% isoamyl acetate. I think you can get away with all ether. You have to be careful how much you use. If you thin it out too much, it will, instead of filling in the error, it just weakens the stencil. But I have made core flu thinner. And don't smoke, for God's sake.
And don't breathe in too deeply.
What?
Anybody want to see a cigar on my middle finger?
One at a time, one at a time. You.
Somebody we know uses acetone.
I don't like acetone, but it will dissolve this stuff. You. Usually, if you're around a university, you get the chemistry people to give you a little bit in a bottle. The isoamyl acetate is harder.
Okay.
Yeah, keep tightly closed.
Otherwise,
I guess you're reduced to using acetone, which is lacquer thinner. It's methylethyl ketone. That'll work fine. Nail polish remover or lacquer thinner.
Okay, Gary, would you describe the difference between the two types of mimeographs, or as Gestetner says, duplicators?
Before you go on there, I might note that there is a hell of a lot of difference between different types of stencils. Gestetner in the U.S., as I've found, if you're using a manual typewriter, almost anything except a Selectric is incredibly preferable just for durability and the fact that it holds up.
Gestetners are fine on Selectrics. They're beautiful on Selectrics.
No, I'm saying that if you have anything other than a Selectric,
yeah.
The Stettner is far preferable.
Ah.
They're fine on Selectrics, too. And in Canada, almost all stencils, okay, anywhere outside the U.S., almost all stencils you'll find will be white, which is really weird. They use a black carbon sheet underneath, and they're
it's
a hell of a lot
more
legible.
Visible, actually.
Yeah,
lots
very
more legible.
Good.
It's very easy to do tracing on.
Yeah, the only one of the white ones I've seen, Guy Lillian had, and they weren't worth anything.
I have
I've seen white
eight quires of Bandas.
But,
they're white. They have a real piece of carbon
yeah,
paper in their
yeah.
fruition, and they
India.
Work pretty well.
Bandas are
hard,
from
though.
India, and they're like they're
yeah.
made of rubber. They stretch.
Yeah, that's what little ones I have didn't stretch.
They're no good. Gestetner
Canada
is pretty good.
They're the best.
Don?
Yeah,
two questions.
How do you spell Gestetner?
G-E-S-T-E-T-N-E-R-M-O-U-S.
They teach it to the little fans when they're four.
Yes.
Gestetner is real good on
anything.
On anything.
It's probably the best stencil.
Okay,
but
Gary's
moving,
going
he made
to discuss the
they are very expensive.
Moving right along.
Yeah.
I just figured out that anywhere outside
no,
the U.S. they're white.
Don't even talk about stencils.
Often rubber here.
Okay, Gary's...
Gestetners. They make a special Selectric stencil
it's,
if you really want to play games, but their regular ones work fine.
It's a softer stencil, that's all.
Okay, I'd rather not to go into too many technical details here, which are only affecting a few minor people in the audience. So, Gary, can you go on to the
yeah.
difference between the two mimeographs?
You may think we're writing notes to one another. We're just playing tic-tac-toe. There are two main kinds of mimeographs. Which are generally referred to as the silkscreen type mimeograph and the pad type mimeograph. And the Gestetner epitomizes the highest quality and most well-known silkscreen mimeograph, and generally the A.B. Dick is the most well-known and epitomial pad mimeograph. Yes. And the chief difference, well, the process of Mimeo has been briefly described, is that you have the stencil here, and you have the wax stencil, which little holes have been made in the form of letters, and this goes on the machine.
Or tracing.
Yes, and ink is forced through it and onto the paper in the shape of the holes. It's a very simple process. A pad mimeograph is just that. It's a set of, like, cotton-like felt material, and it's soaked with ink, and the stencil's on top, and you turn the crank round and round, and the ink comes through the pad and onto the paper. A silkscreen Gestetner, or any kind of silkscreen mimeograph, on the other hand, is made of very fine silkscreen, and is capable of getting much finer repro because the holes through which the ink is forced in the silkscreen is extremely fine, and you can get very, very good resolution, so that a Gestetner, or any kind of silkscreen mimeograph, is always what you want for any kind of reasonable reproduction of illustrations. If you have anything that requires a large black area and you try and run it on a pad mimeograph, what you'll get is this sort of strange triangular pattern because the pad mimeograph underneath it has this metallic metallic covering that the
drum.
Pads on.
Drum.
The drum. Remember Elpidge Purdy did most of Carindy.
It's a lot tougher.
It just takes a hell of a lot of time. And also the liquid ink has a tendency, after a few years, to do like ditto in that it sort of spreads.
There's
look
also
at old
difference.
Carindy's where you use purple ink and the purple ink is sort
of... Purple,
put a
purples are
a
bad.
Lot of glow. All
purples are bad names.
The other difference is that
brown ink.
The two mimeographs use different
brown
kinds of
purple,
slightly mind. Different kinds of inks, one of which is called liquid ink and the other is paste ink. And the difference is naturally that one is very thick and pasty, and that's used in Gestetners.
Thin and liquidy.
Unfortunately,
and
frequently.
Yes, liquid ink tends to have a lot of problems in that liquid spills where paste won't.
Well,
and you can get all over your floor and all over your body, and I know people who mimeograph in the nude and they get very strange looking.
Your skin is washable where your clothes may not
messy.
Be. That's what it comes down
get
to.
It.
Yes.
Well, mimeograph can be messy, yeah. It's best if you, when you go into mimeographing, wash a lot since it's poisonous, and have a bottle of, I forget what the chemical content, I'm sure John can tell us, but typewriter cleaner fluid will cut mimeograph ink.
Amway sells something called LOC, or Lock, which is terrific.
Also, Gestetner has an offset hand cleaner, which apparently will remove Mimeo ink quite nicely. It comes in 2-liter bottles, and I don't think it's terribly expensive.
Yeah.
No.
Okay. Question.
I've got a question over there.
It also cleans stencils without killing them.
I have found that any household cleaner with a high content of ammonia Yeah.
Works just fine. I was using straight ammonia for a while, which is very hard on your nostrils, your lungs, your eyes,
yes.
and your skin. And then I found out the household cleaner doesn't
it's,
wipe you out that bad. It works as well.
It's this mimeograph thing. The one advantage of the guest to clean, which is what you're referring to, is that you not only can clean yourself off and
you can clean the machine
like
too.
You can clean the machine and you can clean stencils. It doesn't dissolve stencils. You just put a little pad on it and wipe it off.
Yeah,
and start
that's cool.
There
it's
are a number.
Easy.
There
if
are
you
a
don't have. Oh, if you don't have terribly sensitive skin, yeah, you just got the ink on your hands. A good scouring
yeah.
powder will
cut
real fast.
The
thing
is, it shouldn't
be
necessary because
clothing
only,
the soap is good to get,
only
you know?
Dangerous or painful expedients like ammonia or scouring powder. A number of commercial cream-style hand cleaners, which will work with or without water. So that even while you're mimeoing, if you get your hands dirty, just pick up some more paper to put in the machine. You've got ink all over the first few pages.
Any
so it's good to keep
support.
Your hands clean while you're working. There are a number of hand cleaners, cream-style hand cleaners, that come in small containers like this. And they, the ink just dissolves right off your hands, and you can wipe them off on paper towel.
Yeah,
and
it's best to clean it fairly quickly because, well, ink, mimeograph ink technically does not dry. and I have 10-year-old fanzines that will still smear on the proper paper.
It just soaks into the fanzine.
There what it does do, it soaks into things, and if you even leave it lying around your machine long enough, it will get a permanent stain.
Okay,
well, then you're going to
makes it hard to do fine work,
next.
Like pick up single
got a question
paper.
Or something?
Loud.
I had a surgical problem not too long ago
still.
In discovering that various paste inks on the Gestetner are not compatible.
Uh-huh.
If I change to another brand of ink, sometimes it seems to coagulate and clog up the screen.
Mm.
Well,
all inks I use are either Gestetner or made
one
for
ink being
Gestetner.
Older than the other.
Yeah.
The grease separates out.
You also do run into the problem.
Yeah.
If you use old ink, yeah, they tends to separate out into oil and water and you get a sort of
yeah.
bizarre blob.
Yeah. So, some winter type paste inks are water based,
really.
Like Rick's ink, for that matter.
Deborah?
Since we all seem to be talking about cleaning, I'd like to mention two of the best things for soaking up ink, especially if you spill it on your machine, is crud sheets, because after all, they are designed to soak up ink. And the second thing is that the best stencil storage that I've ever found was the New York Times,
yes.
which is big enough.
Definitely.
Of course, they changed the paper type. It's not as good, but I had stencils stored in the New York Times that were 5 years old that I reprinted with pretty good success. So, and I didn't clean them either. I just blotted them heavily with crud sheets and stored them in the paper.
A comment on paper. I really think the New York Times is a very good way of storing stencils. As far as paper to print on, there are a number of different kinds of paper that people use to print on. Do we have a sample of Twilltown here?
Yes.
Of
course.
Linda.
Twilltown is the stuff that Deborah is talking about. If you have a sheet that doesn't quite work, you call it a crud sheet. You can't use it for your fanzine, you use it for cleaning up. Twilltown is kind of soft and fluffy. This is very good. This is the best Twilltone I've ever seen. Most Twilltone will fill your machine with Twilltone dust. I hate Twilltone. I will not use Twilltone. I will not have anything to do with Twilltone.
Big
I
fan.
Use Bond paper.
You want to come slip sheet
but
for me?
It has the end.
I have enough trouble slip sheeting for myself. With Bond paper, the ink sits on the surface for a much longer time.
Yes.
You have to slip sheet or you get, I don't really know if you can see this, but there are some tiny little smudges over here.
Huh,
right,
my
where,
fanzine.
Yes,
sir.
Right on your fanzine. Ink from the page underneath this one kind of printed off onto this page. This is a process called set off when it occurs on your Mimeo, and offset when it occurs on an offset press, which is how they do offset.
Hey, I love the bottle time.
Whereas,
I love the bottle
Twilltone. For being a four Twilltone spokesman, just a moment, I have to rebut that. Twilltone has the advantages, however, of that it's extremely, what Twilltone is, it's extremely fibrous. And several Twilltones, genuine Twilltone, if you look, we'll see lots of little. This is Fibertone. Well, even this a little, if you look, it looks like it has lots of teensy little hairs in it. And for all I know, they grind up rats and throw them in. But it's
great.
Very fibrous, and it's extremely absorbent,
yes.
which means that for the most part, you do not have to slip sheet. And
yes.
you can run lots and lots of large black areas.
You can't see one
however,
through the other.
Harking back to Gestetner again.
It's also cheap.
At the Balticon, the Gestetner people had a Mimeo room. And they had all sorts of wonderful things, including two electro-stencil machines, a lot of nice new Mimeos, and they had a bunch of paper. And I said, what is this stuff? They said, it's Gestetner paper. I said, I didn't know you guys made paper. I said, yeah. I said, is it good? I said, of course it's good. I said, gee, this isn't Twilltone or anything. I think they said it was Bond.
Yeah.
I said, well, what do you do about set-off? He says, set-off?
What's that?
This paper won't set off.
Ha!
I said, you have got to be kidding me. He says, no, you use Gestetner ink. On a Gestetner machine, this paper will not set off. So I said, oh yeah? And I took out of the garbage about 200 crud sheets off of one of Tarrell's fanzines. They had trouble with a stencil or with some red ink, right? And here are all these beautiful crud sheets. I took them home and I printed something on them, and by God, the guy was right. It does not set off, and I don't know how they do it.
It's a
but if you print reasonable, yeah, right. David is making motions like this. Gestetner paper, like anything else Gestetner, is not terribly cheap. And like anything else paper, it's exorbitant.
You go for understated
Gestetner stuff
you
is not. You can exorbitant, but Gestetner paper is definitely expensive.
You
can
get, John, the reason Gestetner paper is so expensive, aside from the fact that Gestetner overprices everything they sell, is that Gestetner paper is imported from their own paper mill in Scotland.
Not always. Sometimes
imported Scottish paper.
And you might. And it's probably the best Mimeo bond available, but I'm not sure that's worth all the extra.
I don't know about that.
However, wait a minute. I want my chance to add to Gary's rebuttal against this anti-twill-tone vendetta of singers. And I think I can speak with some authority since I've decided many times for my fine repro, and I'm also probably the only owner in fandom of
a
machine with built-in slip sheeting, not add-on slip sheeting like
Joe
Ross. But built-in
slip sheeting. I think there's at least two others, but we'll go into that later.
In any case, I use twill-tone anyway, and I think the main advantage of it is, aside from the opacity, which means less show through, and the increased absorption qualities, which means less set off, is that it's more fanish. And this is a matter of tradition, perhaps.
Goldenrod!
The days of quandary.
But it is more fanish. And I can prove this to you, not even from citing my own example, but by citing Mike Lixon, who has won the Hugo, the Fanzine Hugo, for best fanzine.
And it was
as
non-trial
you know,
tone.
An argument was published on very fine Gestetner Mimeo bond. But Mike has told me many times that the only reason it was published on that paper is he couldn't get twill tone. He preferred twill tone. And if the
so
paper had been readily available, he would have published
room.
It on twill tone. And we've even discussed on occasion ways of importing it into Canada.
We smuggled it over the border.
Okay, I've got a question from this poor guy in tan who's been trying to.
I'm a production manager for a newspaper, and we watch, you know, all the new products come out. There's a litho company in St. Louis that just come out with a new product. I think it's called Hands On. And you put it on anything, and ink will not absorb through it.
Oh,
you can't
right.
feel it. $3 will give you about a 4 month supply.
All right.
Hands.
Is it a powder Ooh. Liquid?
It's a liquid, and it dries almost instantly. And it gets cold.
Can you put it on your machine?
You can put it on your machine, put it on your hands, put it on your clothes.
Can you go swimming in it?
Water.
Somebody up there repeat the name of it.
What
hands
is the name
off?
Of it?
I think it's Hands Off.
Hands Off. Yeah,
that's
some
Hands Off.
H-A-N-D.
Okay, it was in the winter in June.
While we're on the subject of cleaning, I want to point out something I didn't get to point out before, which is that, ironically enough, there's one thing that will get Gestetner ink and liquid ink out of carpets, woolen sweaters, anything thick, clothy, and woolly, and it's one of the most unguessable things in the world. Ditto fluid.
Yeah.
Methyl hydrate. Ditto conquers Mimeo.
Methyl hydrate?
Methyl
yes.
alcohol.
Well, that's
methyl hydrate.
Methyl hydrate
can.
Is a very bad way of saying methanol.
Yes, right.
Well, that's what it says on the side of the can that I use.
Really?
They want to impress it.
Okay, let's get off of cleaning for a moment.
Well,
it evaporates.
Yes. The other thing about twill
tone. Can we hold the questions a little bit here? And let me go over a few more points, and then we'll go back to the questions. I want to make a point here, and that is that no matter what equipment you have, if you take care of what you're doing, and if you are concerned about getting good reproduction, getting good material, you can put out a quality fanzine. Doesn't matter whether you have a ditto, an offset, a mimeograph. If you work with it, you generally take the cruddiest, most ancient machine in the world and turn out something pretty good on it. Because I used to have one of those machines. And you just have to,
to
keep working on it, testing it, get as much information as you can. And if you see that what you're doing isn't working, then realize that there's something wrong, you know. And a lot of problems are caused by bad typing, which is one reason why I wanted to bring that up first. People just don't know how to type a stencil, how to correct, and a number of people leave in their typos or just type over them, and they never are really concerned enough about their fanzine to do a good job. And if people are just use a little common sense and have a little pride in what they're doing. It's amazing how good you can really produce a fanzine.
Linda, can I add something to that on that score, which I think is of great importance? A lot of people get this idea that they have to have a zine out by a set date. If they don't make...
Wait a minute. These can't be fans.
If they don't make this deadline, something horrible is going to happen. And there are so many fanzines that would look so much better if only the publisher or the editor had taken the time to say, you know, those 5 pages out of the 20 are crud, I'm going to rerun them and let the zine come out a week later. There's nothing pressuring you. This is not the mundane world where you're up against money-type deadlines. And don't make artificial deadlines for yourself. Take your time to do a good job. You'll always be glad when those locks come in. But no cracks from you, Emerson. I know I've taken a long time.
Even if it takes you 4 years, if what you get
now, that
is
was
a good
not
product.
My reason in this case, but that's non sequitur to what I'm saying. It really is. I admit it's ironic, but it's not my reason for discussing the subject. It's just there's so many potential decent fanzines come out as crud zines and reviewed as crud zines. The poor neo-editor's ego is destroyed forever because he hasn't gotten the ego, but he needs to keep it alive. So take your time and do a good job. Don't be in too much of a rush.
Right. One of the banes of the current fan who gets a lot of fanzines is a fairly recent development, which is called the immaculately reproduced crud zine. And it's somebody who gets hold of an offset or goes to a professional mimeographer and they pay money.
Sometimes they learn how to use.
And they get this zine
well.
That has, you know, brilliant black printing and immaculate, you know, 4-color reproduction of this sort of scroll. It looks like a 3-year-old did it. And, you know, brilliantly reproduced, you know, book reviews of Space 1999. And it's very tiring, and it shows up a lot because people don't have too much contact with fans, and don't understand that you don't have to be look fancy. A lot of the syndrome comes, well, part of what Moshe was talking about with having deadlines, one of the chief banes also of a neo, one of the chief problems and things they keep doing is they suffer from imitation prosinitis.
Yeah.
They feel a need that, well, I'm a magazine and I'm just like analog, so I should put a price on the cover, which of course makes no sense because they're not selling it at a newsstand.
Yeah, may as well put approved on the comics code of those.
Yeah, you know, there's no sense in having a date and schedule because you don't need it. You don't have to pay for the post off, you know, have your
also it proves very
clause.
Embarrassing when you fail to meet
yeah.
the schedule, which you
yes.
will.
And the basic flaw is trying to imitate a prosine where it's not needed.
Okay, now I'd like to have Victoria, before I go to the questions, I'd like to have Victoria tell a little bit about where to get a mimeograph.
In Canada.
In Canada, it wouldn't be too different from the States.
$500. Can we hold it for a minute?
Sure.
Prevent set off from one base to the next, which means you have to stand there, and if your machine is electric and has variable speed, you adjust it to suit yourself, and you just stand there and flip them in. A rubber finger, if you can get one, a rubber thumb is
helps
the best to
lot.
Grab the paper.
Otherwise,
but it's not fetish.
How do you do this when you
tacky
have
fingers.
A hand crank?
That's even
easier.
You grab
crank
one hand and slip sheet with the other.
Or you get two people,
some
which is easier.
They don't work usually.
Yes, they do too work.
Or you can add them on.
It works.
And another thing you can do. Which is
okay,
the
slip sheets.
What do you get slip sheets?
Okay, slip sheets are basically crud sheets that are put between the sheets that come out of the machine as it's running to prevent set off from one base to the next, which means you have to stand there. And if your machine is electric and has variable speed, you adjust it to suit yourself, and you just stand there and flip them in. A rubber finger, if you can get one, a rubber thumb is
helps
the best
a lot.
To grab the paper.
Otherwise,
but
I have
it's
lots
not
of
fetish.
How do you do this when you
tacky
have
fingers.
A hand crank?
That's even easier.
You grab
crank
one hand and slip sheet with the other.
Or you get two people, which is easier.
They don't work usually.
Yes, they do too work.
Or you can add them on.
It works.
And another thing you can do for slip sheeting is, well, to avoid slip sheeting, I found that if you don't want to take the time and trouble of slip sheeting or can spend the money for an automatic slip sheeter, tighten your feed, the tray where it comes out of, what's it called? I don't know.
Receiving tray.
Your receiving tray. Tighten it as tight as you can so that
they fall exactly
in. It eliminates the fact that as the pages come down on one another,
they
shift and slide and smear. If it comes down really tight, it eliminates a lot of the set-off problem.
And if you're Walt Willis, you can just throw bits of barley between
them. Okay, I got one question here, then we're going back to Victoria.
It's not really a question, it's just a suggestion. My dealer showed me something a few years ago that I haven't used because I use Toton. split pages. You can go right to the
Will you repeat that, please? Okay, you can take something like a Yellow Pages. Open it up to the back, and as each sheet falls out of the machine, you flip a page of the Yellow Pages on top.
Hey, John, I'm glad you thought of that.
That's really great.
Very clever.
Back to the bottom.
That's marvelous.
There are, manufactured by some companies, slip sheets for Mimeo. I have a bunch of AB Dick slip sheets. They say AB Dick Mimeograph slip sheet on them. They're thick cardboard. They have a little 1-inch hole in the middle. They're about yay big, right? They have plastic ridges on two sides. You drop them down with the plastic ridges touching the ink, and the next sheet falls on top of them. They're really easy to use. I deal them out like cards. As the machine spits out the pages, I spit out the
why the hole
slip sheets. I never did figure that out, Michael. I don't know why the hole.
It's an automatic slip sheeter because it may be, the same similar potential cards with holes, and
probably lighter uses them.
It makes it fall straight.
They work extremely well.
Okay, Victoria.
Okay, for a Mimeo, you can pay anywhere from free to over $1,000, depending on whether you find one. Depending on whether you find one in the back of a bookstore, somebody in Toronto did, or whether you go to Gestetner and buy a brand new machine, top of the line. In Toronto, Daryl Wayne McDonald has a machine bought for 50 cents at an auction sale. It's a 50-year-old Gestetner 66 in perfect working order. So auction sales are a good source. Most often the people that go there don't know what they are, and you can probably bid quite low on them.
That's the back end of a bicycle. I'll give you 25 cents for it.
Another good source is just tracking down rumors. I got my first Mimeo through a rumor. There was a store, happened to have one in the basement, they're selling it. There was a 120, sold for $25. I've since sold it, but tracking down a rumor is a good way. I got another one that way, an electric machine that the store was selling back to the Gestetner company, so I bid them $50 more for it than they would get for it, and I got it.
Yeah, if you live.
So tracking down rumors is a good way. Or knowing an office supply store that's going out of business.
Checking with local fans who are good. We got a hand crank Rex M4 fairly cheap through some local people who have obtained a reputation for getting anybody anything in the way of reproduction equipment.
Five-finger discount.
Okay, want ads.
Midnight Mimeo.
Okay, look in the want ads in the newspapers. And some cities have buy and sell newspapers where you advertise free, and there's often a lot of office equipment advertised.
Sales of state and county property that's being phased out.
Definitely.
Auctions.
Yeah. Check auction
those.
Sales.
Yeah.
Colleges.
You can get,
companies
you can get,
that are closing out and companies that are converting to offset.
Andy Porter talks about finding
good. An awful lot of companies are now converting to offset, and you'll find them throwing out their Mimeo equipment.
And if you got the money to throw around, you can go to the. Oh, yes, one thing that Motion mentioned is you can go to the AB Dick company. They'll often have a Gestetner for sale cheaper than the Gestetner company.
Yeah, right.
They take trade ins.
A point?
Yeah, if they take trade ins, you may be able to get an other brand machine from any given Mimeograph company. Okay, or you can go to the company itself and buy a reconditioned or a new machine from the company itself.
Yeah, that costs.
A brief word of encouragement is that, I live in New York where there tends to be a lot of mimeographs keep turning up. New York fans are all mimeograph fans. And if anyone wants encouragement, local fan Gary Tesser, who had four mimeographs. What?
Did they get here yet?
I don't know. Had four mimeographs, bought five more. He now has nine mimeographs, sold three. And they keep turning up. For it's not at all unreasonable to expect to buy a Gestetner 120. A high price is $100, and it's reasonable for 75 or 50. And if you keep looking in any kind of reasonable city, you can find them. A Gestetner 120, which is sort of the Model T of mimeograph.
Rolls Royce, that's what you mean.
Well, in that it lasts,
I have a store
and I have a 20-year-old. I've used now the tester's 20-year-old mimeograph. It's in perfect working order. There are no advantages that the current Gestetner have over it, aside from being electric and having a slightly better feed, a slightly better ink.
Oh, I should say something.
There's really
about,
not very much advantage.
I should say something about if you are willing to pay the money. A good electric machine, fairly modern, say a 360 Gestetner, which would be from 10 to 15 years old, from the Gestetner company, would run in the order of $600.
Oh, a word of.
Con Selectrics floating around in Atlanta, and they're still available.
Maybe not in Detroit. I don't know. Maybe Detroit is really
clean
on gun. machines are what, selling a Rex rotary?
Under their brand.
That's really weird, because Gestetner owns Rex
rotary. Their number for it is 560. If you happen to be a Rex rotary M4 owner, say, it uses the same ink can as the M4, which benefits.
How you, as an artist, how you draw on stencil, and how you letter on stencil.
First thing is, you have a stencil and you have a plyophil, which you conveniently rip off and throw away because it's absolutely useless in this operation. You must have either a drawing plate or a lettering sheet or even a typing plate, something to go under the stencil. Carbon paper or
glass, nothing else.
White backing sheet for this, which this goes under altogether. And then you have a nice drawing surface. Lettering guides are sold by Gestetner and AB Dick and probably other people.
Speedo Print.
AB Dick has a nice selection, and they're all relatively expensive, from about $2.50 to $4 or $5. If you're choose wise, you can get two or three that'll do suit most of your needs with a minimal amount of expenditure. You can draw on a stencil with a pencil if you're very light to set guidelines, but you can use the numbers on the side of the stencil to keep your lettering guide straight if you want. So, we'll get to that. If you are carving out a letter, you use several types of styluses. The one you want is a lettering guide stylus, which is the thinnest of all, which you just stick into the guide and trace around. And you push hard, and you learn how hard to push without tearing the stencil and yet giving a good impression.
Make sure that when you
go right, the stencil angling the stylus.
With one little trick, which is a Ted White trick here. I don't happen to have another one of these.
Oh, yeah.
What you do is if you have two lettering guides, you put one down underneath, line it up according to the numbers, which are presumably straight on both sides, like 20 on one side, 20 on the other. You line it up so you've got a straight line. Then you keep it there and you put your other guide on top. And then just hold the bottom guide and it keeps you straight.
I tend, instead of holding it, I put something heavy weight, like a glass of water or coffee when you
could use a T-square.
Any kind of T-square or straight edge, anything like that. Yeah.
And of course there are such things as mimeoscopes, which are quite expensive, $70, $80.
If you can find one.
If you can find them with T-squares and so on.
People in New York have recently been finding things like mimeoscopes at auctions. Somebody bought an $85 mimeoscope for $15 at an auction. I was reduced to making one out of a piece of safety plate glass and a cardboard box that I
something you can do if you're something you can do if you're feeling energetic and if you've got an old coffee table with the board top.
Oh right.
You can still eat off it or play cards on it. Cut a hole in the middle, set in a plate of frosted glass, put a light under it.
Couple of fluorescent lamps underneath it. Yeah. Great.
That you're in business, and you can still use it to play cards on it.
Okay, back to tarot. Sorry about that.
That's lettering. That's about all there is to lettering. The rest of it is artistic sense. Now, drawing on stencil. The first thing I should say is you should never draw on stencil unless you have an artist who's doing original illustration on stencil.
Yeah.
It is an inferior method of duplication that few people have the skill to carry off well. And a lot of artists will bitch like crazy when they find their immaculately drawn illustration turn into scratchy lines badly on a stencil.
If you care to practice for 5 or 6 years, you might be able to do it well.
However, if I can throw in one thing is that while it might be somewhat of a lost art of drawing on stencil because electronic stenciling, which we'll get into shortly, has become so popular. In the early days, before that was possible, there became quite a few people who were extremely talented at drawing on stencil.
Some of whom and are still around.
A few are still around, like Ross Chamberlain.
There are two factors here. One is the artist, like Styles, Chamberlain, Fletcher, Jay Kinney, or Reed Waller, for example, who was Stu Schiffman, too, yes, who were still around, still active, people who were trying to keep the art alive or reviving it, who do the art really on stencil themselves. But the more common case was that of the fan editor, who in many cases was not an artistic person to begin with, who had to learn to trace other people's art.
Yes.
In fact, most of you are familiar with Bill Rossler's style of cartooning. One of the reasons Rossler draws these sketchy little cartoons is because they're easy to trace.
Yeah.
And when he started out in fandom, there wasn't electronic stenciling generally available. You had to trace
your artwork. And he made his artwork so that could be readily traced by even the clumsiest fan ad after a little
bit
of practice.
In fact, I think a lot of fanish taste in artwork was largely modeled by the fact that it had to be something that could be traced on a stencil.
Yes, I think
or
you're
drawn
right.
On a
taste, yeah. It's a matter of necessity. Somebody like Grant Canfield would not have gotten very far in 1953.
No, some of them would have been.
Scissors and
so in a sense, it's become an entirely separate art form on its own in creating the exactly, learning what proportion you can draw with shading plates. There are various styles of different patterns that can be used in styluses. And it is entirely separate art form, which can be quite, require a lot of talent and be quite beautiful.
Okay. You want to go ahead, Terrell?
What it more or less boils down to is if you've got somebody else's artwork, don't trace it unless you know you're an expert. Okay.
How do you know you're an expert?
Practice a lot yourself.
Probably you're an artist yourself.
Even if you're an expert, you tend to impress your own style.
Yeah.
On it.
It's just like the anchor in a comic.
But it's
you
so
can
much
do.
Cheaper than electro.
If you notice
this
you're impressing your style, don't do it.
Okay, if you use up four stencils doing it, it's not quite, it's still cheaper, but it's getting there.
Or if you own your own electro stenciler, which a number of fans are starting to do.
Yes.
So, when drawing on stencil, an original illustration, there are a number of tools you can have. There are wheels, which will give you dotted lines and stippled lines, which are somewhat cranky and a little kish, I find. Some people like them. There are writing styluses, which are straight and have a little ball in the end. These are useful for heavy lines and lettering, sometimes freehand lettering. And then there are drawing loops, which are useful for some things. I don't use one.
They're useful for calligrapher type effects.
Yeah.
Thin, thick lines.
But surprisingly enough, you can use a lettering guide stylus, the very thinnest one, for drawing, if you're careful. It'll give you the thinnest line possible. There are shading plates, such as this, where you get a stylus with a blunt end. You put it under the stencil, rough part up, and you move this over the top, pressing, and it'll give you a stippled pattern or a...
They can't see that.
Too bad we can't
around.
Just print
yeah.
these
things.
If, this
yeah. if we had an overhead projector, that'd be great.
If this is a Canadian stencil, you could see it work, but not this.
Well, hold it up, hold it to the light.
The process is analogous to that, to taking a rubbing.
Here, give me the...
You get a. It reproduces the textured surface of the shading plate, and they come in all different kinds of patterns.
You can even get some that'll have little roses on them.
Yeah, Christmas trees. Oh yeah, this is clearly visible from here. I don't know whether the TV camera
can
pick it
up.
Yes, heavy dot.
That's some sort of a checkered pattern.
Oh.
If you want to pass that around.
You can take those little shading plates, do some buffing,
and
rotate the shading plate and get a neat wire pattern.
You can use other
like
things if you don't want shading plates. Sandpaper will sort of work. I've used steel wool.
A really nice one that had people giving people fits in one of my appas is if you have anything with a metal case with a crackle finish paint,
right?
Those come up in very fine ridges, and they cut a beautiful stencil, and it will drive people nuts trying
also,
to figure out where
you
get shading plates.
You think leather. I watched Ross Chamberlain do a piece of ditto art where he had no shading plates handy. It was at Andy Porter's house, and Andy doesn't do artwork. So he used the fake leather on Andy's stereo for
Andy's
a shading plate. You can use any damn thing you can find that has any kind of texture for a shading plate. You can use this for a shading plate. For
a cloth-covered notebook.
This wouldn't work too well, but yeah, cloth-covered notebooks like that.
And if you don't want to spend money on a lettering guide, you can buy 10-cent rulers with the alphabet cut in it or cardboard.
Or you can learn to be, if you have a good hand, you can learn to just
freehand
letters and numbers on stencils in any style
you
want.
Or
you
can get
want.
A general circular or elliptical template for 69 cents at all.
Some people have carried the art of hand lettering to a bit of an art, too. A fan artist by the name of Arthur Thompson, also known by a shortened version of Adam, developed a very unique style of drawing letters with little dots at the end. And Stu Schiffman is developing his own style, and Ken Fletcher does it his way. John Barry.
Okay.
The Couch family came up with a method of you draw a you draw the letters with very heavy magic marker, and you sort of overlap them a little, and then you trace that on the stencil, tracing around the outlines with a stylus,
what you can do is
and then shading in.
What you can do is get a permanent magic marker and draw it on the stencil, then draw it around.
Yes. A lot of magic markers will perforate the stencil without knowing it.
Some of them have a nice strong solvent in them, which neatly dissolves the wax, and then you get all sorts of crud.
Okay, before I go to these two questions, let me just interject something before I forget it. There's going to be a Fanzine fan party tonight, which I am holding, and it's going to be in room 1675 and 83. It's a suite. It's weird. 83 is around the corner. It's the Phoenix suite, which they've kindly lent to me. So it's for 1675. It's for fanzine fans only. You're all invited, and you can bring your fanzine fans friends, but try not to bring everybody at the convention.
When?
At midnight, hopefully. In other words, after the dramatic presentation.
What films are running tonight?
Midnight special too.
Now, first I'm going to have Devra with her question.
I had 2 points to make. One thing goes back to working with the stencils with basic Mimeo, because when I borrowed Frank Credo's Mimeo, he said, ink the silk screen before you put the stencils
definitely.
On.
Definitely.
And I did it for the first stencil in each run, and after about a year, I developed a lengthwise wrinkle in the stencil, in the silk screen. So maybe there are some other people who aren't aware either, and that was a very expensive silk screen. You have to ink between your stencils as well as the beginning of printing.
What? No, every time you go to put a stencil on, you ink the machine first, right?
Yes,
yeah.
When I thought that there might be some sucker who had missed out on this. And the other thing is that there is a kind of silk sheet, which Juanita Coulson used to use very heavily in shading, which produces the finest shading I've ever seen.
Oh.
It's beautiful. I think you can buy it from Speed Print. I always think it's called Speed of Wall. They have a very fine soft stencil called Sovereign, which is very good for drawing on, but expensive. And maybe somebody should say that higher products are not worth buying.
If we're going to strange methods of shading, I might mention something that's fairly obsolete, but you still find occasionally, which is something called brush stenciling, which is a very strange, bizarre kind of stenciling, and it's extremely sensitive to this sort of wire brush, and you can get a very unique shading pattern with it too.
Wow. What you use is a strange fluid which eats up the stencil, except for the it eats off the wax and leaves the stencil part that's not opaque to ink.
Yeah. Okay, I've got a question here. What is your name? I can't quite.
Jim.
Hi there. Okay, Jim.
Okay, one little trick to transfer original art. If you know the artist, get him to draw it on a piece of thin plexiglass with a stylus. You then have a plate for original etching. And then you run it right over your stencil. You just put it right underneath and you just rub it on. You've got the original art the way he drew it. You're not doing anything but putting it on your stencil. With anything, a roller will work fine.
Hard rubber roller?
Hard rubber roller will work beautifully.
Ooh,
he's got his original
myself.
Plate back. He can make his edge.
Just poke right through the wax and symbol.
And you have tried this.
Also, the wax will transfer.
And it worked first. Okay.
Now, this is something that might be of interest here. All right, now, in Atlanta, we have a couple of good dealers. Okay, those of you who have Rex Rotary M4s or any machine which uses a similar can, I don't know if any that do besides that, but I can get the Rex Rotary M4 ink in black only, it's Rex Rotary's own ink, for $3.80 a can. If anybody's interested in this, give me your address after this is over and I'll, you know, round some up for you or get you the address of the people. Also, I'm getting the Topsham Mimeo, it's fiber paper, 12-tone type, which somebody mentioned earlier. Right now, the place I'm thinking of is selling it for $1.59 a ream.
Oh, God.
In 20 pounds. Their regular price is $2.15 a ream, and if you buy 20 reams, it drops off to $1.80-something.
But I pay $1.59.
I can also throw in
that. Now, this
a
place has a mailing list,
content
and if anybody wants to put on their mailing list for sales, etc., they run. What? No, this is Sloan Paper in Atlanta. You can give me your name and address. I'll get you on their mailing list. They'll send you a circular. Now, I don't know what shipping will do to this at that range, but if you buy, you know, 4 or 5 reams, I would guess the UPS shipping will not bring it back up to whatever price you're paying in your area.
Yeah. Not
I can throw in the
ring.
Same thing that Walters of, where is it?
Wasika.
Yeah, Minnesota also has they have a 12-tone sale. You continually get their bulletins which say, sale lasts only 2 weeks, order now! It's been going on for about 3-4 years now. and
well,
it's also...
They break it for a
it's
week.
It's Topsham, yeah, break it for a week. Topsham at $1.69.
It's not Topsham, it's their own paper. It's like Topsham.
Yeah, but it's pretty good paper. It's very much 12-tone-y.
And I'd like to point out that you can always get cheaper supplies by ordering in quantity.
Yeah.
So if you can get together with your friends, that's great. Save up and buy 100 reams of paper, and just if you can save up enough money, that is, and just keep it. And it does keep, you can keep stencils and ink for years, and I've done it. Now, before I, Leia, one question from Leia, and then we're going to discuss electro stencils.
This is Fanac. Go back to Mimeo. When you talked about pad-type Mimeos, you did not discuss the difference between open drum and
Oh,
oh boy.
Open drum is neat.
Messy.
Closed drum is neat.
You can't get rid of that. You have to publish a fanzine on it.
I will sell you for $15 along with some ink and some stylus.
You have to publish impressions on that.
It originally belonged to Warren J. Johnson.
Imp. I have one that originally belonged to Tony Specko on a train.
As long as it feeds, it's worth it.
Yeah, is the feed okay? Does it feed paper okay?
I have never used it. Roger used it after.
I don't like
it. Yes, it feeds paper okay when I try.
Okay, now.
That comes with the ink.
Who here would like to talk about electro stencils?
I would.
You're going to say that. Okay,
can
John.
Carol
first, and then I'll tell the last thing about drawing on stencil, and it applies to typing on stencil. If there's anything you must have the best of, it is stencils. You can have an inadequate machine. You can have cheap paper, but you must have good stencils if you're going to have good reproduction, or you're going to do good lettering on it, or good artwork drawn on it. One thing you must get, good stencils. Buy Gestep if you can. Don't buy large amounts of unknown brands of stencils.
Yeah, John Boardman had a severe problem. He bought a bunch of stencils, and they were just so hard that he couldn't do anything with them. You know, he typed them, and you could just about read his fanzines, because the typer, which was a regular knife-edge face, not like a selectric, still couldn't cut through them.
Stencils do dry out after,
yeah, they dry out after a long enough time.
Bruce Arthur's once bought 50
quires. Some stencils have uneven amounts of wax.
Yes. Yeah, these were uneven wax, too, and they were hard. Yeah.
I brought a bunch which, when I put on the Mimeo, I turned the crank, and it dissolved into 15 little pieces of paper. They weren't too good. Everyone has hard gels.
Okay, John on electro stencils.
Yeah, okay. Now, there are machines which will take a piece of artwork, and it's essentially a fax machine, a facsimile machine. It makes a duplicate on a special electronic stencil. These are made out of vinyl with carbon in them. They're electrically conductive, and the way it has a little electrode on the one side and a little light on the other. It shines the light on the stuff, and wherever it's dark, it generates a signal right in a multiplier phototube, which gets amplified and sent through as a high frequency, high voltage impulse to the little electrode. It literally burns a hole by an electric arc. Electric arcs are pretty hot. Burns a hole in the vinyl stencil. Now, these tend to cost anywhere from about 35 cents a piece if you buy them yourself and have your own electro stenciling machine,
$5.
To $5 a piece if you go to the wrong place.
Just sitting there.
Yeah, you don't really want to spend more than $2 or $2.50 at an absolute maximum for an electro stencil. Now, there are many factors that are variable. As example, the number of lines per inch, because as the drum rotates, the thing slowly moves across it, right? And you can adjust on some of them the number of lines per inch that it will cut. You can set contrast and absolute brightness level on some of the better Gestetners are really incredible.
Yeah.
You can set all sorts of, you can just stick a photograph into a Gestetner and run it right off. And you get a stencil that will print a fairly decent version of the photograph. Now, once you get your art and paste it up, by the way, a word on artwork. Artists have to live off their artwork. If an artist sends you a piece of art on a piece of paper this big, and the artwork is that big, you do not cut out a little diamond with the artwork in the middle. This is crapping on your artist. Don't do it. You will find that artists will stop dealing with you if you don't send their artwork back. If you crap it up, like by cutting corners out of it.
Fold it.
Don't do things like that.
And rubber
cement.
Put tape on it.
Don't put rubber cement on it.
How do you stick it down then?
You be real careful. You have to be very careful.
I've never had anybody complain about rubber cement in the
past.
A lot of artists, it'll start turning brown.
And a lot of artists want to sell the art at sketch tables when you return.
That's right. Some artists want to put some of this stuff in their portfolios. If it has corners cut out, you can't put it in your portfolio.
So how can you make a paste up?
You can use a small amount of rubber cement
Xerox.
For the corners.
Yeah,
small
tiny
amount.
Little corners or Xerox if you have a very good Xerox. You have to be very careful. You make the paste up, put it in the e-stencil machine, take it out, make sure your e-stencil is okay, and then remove the rubber cement carefully from the edges.
The simplest solution is just a simple use of Xeroxing. And I know a couple of artists like Joe Pearson who I found. Don't ever send out original artwork. They draw it and they Xerox it, and I mean this is fine scale Xerox. This is not your great slimy
Xeroxing. 4,000,
and they just send out the Xerox, and you can do whatever you want. You know, cut it up, eat it, do whatever you want. It doesn't damage it.
As long as you
so
don't.
That solves the problem.
Okay, now, what you have to do is you take a bunch of pieces of artwork and you arrange them on a white sheet, usually, what, 8.5 by 14?
The reason for this is because it's cheaper. An electro stencil, if you go to Gestetner or one of the places, it costs you $4 for an electro stencil.
And they'll botch
now,
it up.
If, and type, generally, straight type, it does not turn out as well on an electro stencil. So if you want really good repro of your artwork and your type, you're best off having an electro stencil of the artwork and a type stencil, and then combining the two together.
This gets into a difficult technique.
You have to see it done, really.
Yeah, I wish I had a sample here I could do for you. What you do is you set your artwork up on a nice sheet of paper. You run it through the machine, you get all this electro stencil artwork. Then you clip out the artwork as you need it. When you design the page, when you lay out the page, you must allow sufficient space around the edge of the artwork that you have room to set it in. Because usually you'll be setting it in with, say, half-inch wide magic tape or with stencil cement or something like that. What you do is you type up the page, right? You take a piece of artwork, you cut it out to shape.
And you leave a space.
Yeah, and you leave a space for the artwork. Leave plenty of room at the edges. I have had a great deal of difficulty trying to inset artwork where there wasn't room.
John, you should mention that you can get around that by using a separate stencil for the artwork.
Yeah, you can, of course, run separate stencils.
That's
called
being rich.
Then if you lose registration, right, if let's say you print one of them a little too high by accident every once in a while, you get a lot of cred sheets.
That goes right good to Gestetner machine.
Even a really good machine will do that once in a while. So what you do is you cut the piece of artwork to shape, and you make an outline on the stencil with a magic marker that won't hole through the stencil, and you cut a little bit inside the outline, and you magic tape it down, being very careful not to stretch it or wrinkle it. Electro stencils, once they get stretched, stay stretched, and they wrinkle like hell. They are terrible to deal with once they're wrinkled. You want to be very careful.
They always
advice.
Wrinkle.
There are two kinds of electro stencils. There's one that's the generally called, which is called vinyl stencil, and it's sort of rubbery, and what John is talking about.
Right.
It's on a white backing sheet, and it stretches, and it's generally what you use. There's another kind called a paper electro stencil.
It's called crappy.
Don't use it! It wrinkles,
it
tips, it rips,
tears it.
They look like wax paper with stuff in them.
Stay away from
it.
Okay, we have a question or a comment. A comment.
On two of my three fanzines, we used electro stencil art, and we used the kind with the vinyl and the white backing. In the first two or three, we tried to set in, as you talked about, we had trouble with them stretching. The trick is that when you cut them apart, it's still on the backing sheet.
Take it off.
You set it in with the backing sheet still on.
I do that.
And
right.
When it dries completely, then you peel the backing sheet off.
But it may
rip
off.
Smooth
what,
and beautiful.
What happens when I try that is I set it in. I usually set them in with magic tape so they're dry immediately. When I go to peel the backing sheet off, it stretches the stencil,
well,
which then wrinkles to hell.
I
set them in without the backing sheet on them, just very carefully on a piece
this
of glass.
So
and it still wrinkles
this.
To hell.
Yeah.
Sometimes
yeah.
They wrinkle and sometimes they don't.
This is escalating the sort of a Fanac religious war, but it mainly depends on
you do
on
it however it
is.
Works best for you.
Yeah.
Practice a lot.
If you ripple the edge with an X-Acto knife or a pin, you can usually start at a corner of the stencil peeling, and then you can peel off
sometimes
the back.
Sometimes you peel around the edges and work inward.
Okay, if you don't know how to do this technique and want to learn about it,
call one of us.
Call one of us. Ask. You really have to see it to know how to do it well.
Yeah, you have to see.
And
you
have
way
to work
doing
with it.
You know.
And the more you do, the more expert you can become, and you can eventually learn to use less and less margins. Now I got one comment here, and then I want to have questions that. Things you want to know about your mimeography.
In terms of access to electro stencils, it helps to be a student in a college or have contacts with government agencies or large corporations, but especially colleges. Like Queens College, which Stu Schiffman and I were at, we had a science fiction club. And we belonged to the Interclub Council. The Interclub Council had an electro stencil, which all clubs were able to use free of charge.
Yeah, look at the job it did on Placebo One.
You don't have that sort of access.
Yeah, I know.
To
the
same is true.
I'm using that as an example.
A point. There are now more and more fans who own electro stencil machines of varying quality.
Very cheap, 75 cents to $2.
75 cents to $2, because you know they do have to upkeep the machines.
And they know how to run it better than Gestetner's rule.
That's right. Fans get a lot of practice. They know how to set their own, you know, they have their own
and
machine.
They care.
And they don't have to switch machines all the time. They know how to use it, and they care. Very important. important. Yeah. Farmers right, take care.
And Gestetner is used to, all the professional places are used to getting in print or common advertisements, and they slop it on the machine and they run it off, and usually it's just some, you know, twerp works in the office and they turn it on and off. They're not used to getting complex artwork as you get in fanzines. They're not used to intricate line detail and all the different things that you can get.
Once you find a good electro stencil shop that is willing to run tests on your intricate artwork, I found one in Greenville. And
you're lucky.
That's the only reason I'm sorry I moved out of Greenville. Once you find a place like that,
stick with
them. Cherish this. Bring them business. Tell your friends.
How much
these
they
are
charge?
Good people. They were $2 a stencil. And
that's
they
good.
They,
for commercial, that's great.
They had two or three Bosch stencils on hand, you know, that they had noticed were going wrong at the start. And if you came in with something that they'd never seen before that was tricky, they would slap it
in the
machine.
Context of test.
They would run a strip that wide.
Check it out.
To see how it was going to do. And they'd set it up on their own Gestetner or whatever. And they crank it off and see how it printed, and if it did good, then they said, okay, we'll do it, now you pay us for it. Yeah, also, they botched one on, they botched one once, semi-botched, and
didn't charge
we
it.
Noticed it and they didn't charge for it.
Very good.
In the context of tests, there's a stuff called permanent record paper, or PRP paper,
right,
which is a lot cheaper than an electric stencil is, and it produces an image in a similar way, and you can use that to make tests for adjustments, and it's a lot cheaper. Now, Gestetner and Rex and some of the other companies carry it, and
calling it PRP paper is redundant. It's PR paper.
All right. And that's a way to get around that testing problem. But as he points out, the basic technique you can use is similar to what you'd use in the darkroom when you're making a photo test strip. You do a narrow band of an inch or so of a typical section of your illustration. Change your adjustments if it doesn't look right, try again.
Yeah, I brought them one with a starry night sky, and gave them fits. It took them an hour to get the tests right, but then we were good.
I've got a comment here. How about a Fanish Repro Access Network? In other words, matching needs to supply and access. In other words, everybody getting together and buying their materials all at one place.
That's efficient. It's on
now,
Fanish.
It's efficient, it would be beautiful, but there's one major problem, and that is, of course, distance. How are you going to ship
local
stuff
local
around?
You have local
groups.
Rex have a dial.
If you
set.
Keep having that problem, they mean you have a worn roller and should have a service.
Yeah, or there are waiver rollers inside your stuff. Or if you have a gun, it may have a clogged hole. This is what the Gestetner owner's bulletin is for. The very first issue said how to clean out your ink gun, because it gets clogged with 12-town dust from the corpse that use 12-town. Or it gets clogged with cruddy ink from people who use cheap ink because they can't afford good ink. Or you leave it sit for a year and a half and it gets clogged. There are all sorts of things that can cause bad repro of that sort. Then if you get a loose silk screen, on Akos, the top left corner of the page always printed badly. And I suspect now, from watching John Boardman have the same problem, it was a loose corner on the silk screen. Okay, you gotta make sure your silk screen is tight. If you got a pad Mimeo, you have to make sure the pad is clean. Pads get clogged, you have to replace them.
They're cheap.
And if you have
usually
any
they're
problems,
cheap. They're stock of felt, you know.
You can always hire John Singer to come and be an expert and diagnose your problems.
It's a bit of an exotic problem, whereas every third copy comes out with a funny blank line right in your text. That means you have to check your inside rollers for hair or another.
Oh, that's gross. Then you get wrinkled stencils. Okay, one thing you have to learn, and it can only be learned by practice, is first of all how to put your stencil on the machine so it doesn't wrinkle in the first place.
Second.
And second of all, once it does wrinkle, how to straighten it out.
Yes.
What I usually do on my Gestetner 260s is I ink fairly heavily before I start, and I put the top of the stencil on and I flip the stencil back over my hand and I go crank so that the machine is going this way and the stencil is coming around that way. And I press down on it as it goes on, right? Then I pick up the backing sheet and I look at it to make sure it's okay.
So
then,
your hand is, in effect, a roller for putting
it on. A roller for putting it on. Now, the newest Gestetners, which I saw one at Balticon, have a nice little thing in them, which you lay the stencil over the thing, attach it, and you go, whip. And it just puts it on for you. No wrinkles, nothing.
It's
perfect every
metal
time.
Hand, in other words.
Understand, the word thing is copyright 1976. Don't use it without permission.
I will get him later. He will appear in fanzines.
Bits of me, chopped up.
Bits of him in the back of Zenium.
Right, in the back of Zenium, right.
No, I'm not a snake. I'm not a photograph.
Do we have any other questions over trying to kind of wrap this up, and I've got a feeling there may be some people with questions.
We also
got
to do how to straighten out wrinkles once they occur.
Oh, yes. Tell them about how to straighten out wrinkles.
With a stentner offset hand cleaner or K2R spot lifter or something like that.
Like I said,
you
ditto fluid.
Ditto fluid, yeah.
Well,
check the ditto fluid on an inaccessible corner to make sure it won't. Okay, wrinkles. If you once get a wrinkled stencil, my usual technique is I grab the bottom and I carefully back up the machine and pull it off and reset it, holding on at the bottom. Now, doing this with one person is difficult. It requires a great deal of practice. Also, if you get vertical wrinkles and you're inked well enough, or if you're not inked well enough, you can ink more. You can very gently pull on the edges. You kind of press down a little bit and foam apart.
You've got to
be very careful. You get rips. If you have electro stencils, your artwork suddenly you get Bozo the Clown. Instead of being this wide, he's this wide. It doesn't work too well. Be very careful with electro stencils. They stretch like hell.
But
except
the
paper
stencil, you can
and if you have stencils that If you have stencils that don't fit, you can always use magic tape. Scotch magic tape is a necessity for all fan editors
to
have.
Yeah, for example,
not the yellow
if you have only four-hole header stencils, which are about yay wide, and you have a Gestetner machine, which is about yay wide, the first thing you do is learn how to make new headers with a paper punch, right? You take a Gestetner header and you measure the height, and you go across the nine holes with the paper punch, and then you just run a strip of magic tape down each side of the thing. A word about margins. Please, everybody, please leave a margin. I cannot read through staples, and neither can you. I will not unstaple a zine or an appa
to
read the inch and a half of print that's obscured. Leave margins. What's that?
What about artists leaving margins?
Artists should leave margins also.
Unless
but
it's
if
intended
you're doing,
that the art come out of the gutter.
That's right. If the art has to come out of the gutter,
bleed,
that's fine.
Forget it.
Yeah. Right.
Okay, we had a question here.
What do you do if your artist has a habit of sending you his artwork already mounted on a board?
Okay.
Get
a Xerox. Your best bet is to get, so this is expensive as hell, get somebody with a copy camera and have them put it on litho film. Then you will have, I guess you'll probably have a negative. You could probably get them to make a positive also on litho film. And you can have them change the size while they're at it. Yep. Once you get it on litho film, you make an e-stencil off the litho film.
Anytime,
or else you go photo offset.
Send it back to the artist.
Any town over about 20,000 population has got at least one blueprint and such printmakers company.
Yeah.
Greenville has three, et cetera. Okay, they usually have Stat King type machines, which makes the same sort of thing, but they do it on paper, and they're cheap, and they're automated, and
and it's not a negative, it makes a positive.
Well, it makes a negative,
positive,
and then they have to reshoot it. But
reshoot,
It's cheap. It's
you do tend to lose a little bit of detail or contrast, unless you're exceedingly careful.
You've got a comment down here about electrostencil paste-ups.
Yeah. When you're doing a sheet of illos to have electrostencil, whether you take it to a commercial service or send it to a fan who doesn't, there are some guidelines. For example, all illos of about the same heaviness of line should be all on one page, but don't put a very fine-lined illo on the same page as something very heavy and black, because the machine can be set optimally for one or the other.
Don't put
it on
Lizzie Austin with a Frank Canfield.
And the other thing is, if you have something that's on fairly thick board, it's best to Xerox it, because if you see the electrostencil has a curved drum that the page has to wrap around and be covered by a plastic sheet. And if the paper is too thick, then it
bulge.
There's a bulge, and it causes a burn mark on the completed electrostencil, which is difficult to core flue or tape over.
Don't use regular core flue on electrostencils. If you have to core flue, then buy special e-stencil core flue, because you will be sorry.
You can do it when it's on the machine.
They pucker.
You can do it when it's on the machine.
Stretch
it when
it's on the machine.
But
it works fine.
But the e-stencil stuff doesn't dry very quickly.
Yeah. Another word about bleeds. You can bleed off the right hand and the left hand side. Yeah, you might get a little bit of offsetting on the other side of the page from the roller if your machine takes the paper in a little, put sideways back and forth. You can't bleed off the top and bottom. You'll get all sorts of terrible offsetting.
Oh yeah, terrible things.
You can't bleed too well off the sides if you've got strippers stripping the paper
off. Oh yeah,
well, if you can
right
take your strippers off and just seal it off the silkscreen by hand.
Something
you
can
do
a lot of black. Take them off.
It takes a long. It takes more time, but it's pretty easy.
Something that people might consider as a relatively low cost alternative to e-stenciling, if you can make it work, which I did sometimes and didn't other times, it's hit or miss, is a thermofax stencil.
Yeah, I hate them. I've never succeeded in
I've got very good results, and I have gotten terrible results.
I've gotten
they're
terrible
better
at the same
time.
Thermofax machines can be made to produce Ditto Masters, which they do tolerably well.
Beautiful Ditto Masters.
Yeah, I've gotten
Xerox
some nice
copies.
Ditto, even art on Ditto. Yeah. And they can be made to produce stencils, which they do usually very badly.
Now, John, if you saw in the taps that just came out from Kurt Erickson, in three colors, including
a lot of thermoset lettering.
But that's typing. That's not artwork.
No, he did. Well, that's what I'm about to say. It's good for some things and not for others.
Yeah.
Fine details.
I ran a cover on my zine.
But for things like here, for example, this isn't an example of it really, but if you had a typeface in press type or something, Thermofax can do a decent job with that. The detail is not too fine.
Zip a tone, the whole bit. Another thing, when you
expect too much of it, it'll be okay.
Anytime you're working with Thermofax, if you're using the one-pass Thermofax, which is what most of them are, try to work from a Xerox instead of an original.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Xerox or an SCM copy or like that. But you have to be careful not to fuse the Xerox carbon into the back of the stencil, in which case...
You know, something should be said about, I don't think people are really using electronic stencil machines to their utmost capacity.
No.
They have a great potential to be used creatively as part of the medium.
Yeah.
You can, for example, take a single piece of artwork, assuming it's appropriate for this kind of a use, and by shifting it, re-electro-stenciling on the same electro-stencil, shifting again, you get a multiple image, for example.
Yeah.
Or you can take your electronic stencil, put it on upside down.
So many people
and get a reverse.
Yeah, you so many people sacrifice what could be a good graphic effect by assuming that an LO always has to be put in the way it was drawn. I mean, put it backwards.
You have to be careful.
That. Check that with your
artist.
Hold it up to a mirror and see
Patrick
how it
has learned from experience what a great benefit it is to put things in backwards. And
this is much more frequent on four-hole machines where the top of the stencil is utterly symmetrical. You turn around backwards, they go right on. Because stenciles, you can't do that unless you do heavy modifications.
The idea
is very good because unless you want your print to come out backwards, you have to be very careful with four-hole machines.
Okay,
yeah, some people do.
I have a kind of question. I have occasionally had a lot of trouble, usually with pastes. You paste your picture in and you glue the edges and then you cover the edges over with magic tape and then you get this neat little dribble coming out of the bottom. So you go back and you core fluid and you stick a piece of tape on and it works for two sheets and then you get a new dribble.
You're over inking. You should use Mimeo cement rather than tape. I prefer tape. Or both.
Core glue is not so good.
I mean, when you make it up originally, when you do it originally,
use the cement
and then possibly tape.
Yes, or just cement.
Let the cement dry thoroughly before you tape it.
You may be putting some. Maybe taking electric stencil and laying the wax stencil over and then painting cement over that. That doesn't work very well.
No. I know what your problem is.
Right. Okay.
Basically, it's a problem of over-inking, and just the ink builds up under there, and eventually it slips through. And you just have to work on your own method to keep stopping it somehow. It's a mess. Yes, it's always with artwork, black artwork, where you're over-inking, and especially in the summer when it's hot and it runs.
Well, that's because when you have a large black area, the ink all tends to flow towards that area on the stencil, and you get a creep, and the stencil begins to creep up, and it begins to leak out.
And there's not much you can do except figure out your own method of how to correct it. I lift it up, I cut off the little edge, I tape it down, I run 10, I lift it up, I cut it off, I core flow 10.
Vary the position of the stencil.
Put more tape on, you get closer and closer to the letter.
Well, then you have to lift up all the... You lift up all the tape.
You can lift your stencil and scrape
a
lot of excess ink off your sunscreen.
What you can do without doing that is cut a little piece of wax stencil you spoiled. Keep little odds and ends of stencil you have, and then cement that on top of the leak.
And run it fast. Start running it fast. Forget about the black.
Something else you can do is when you know you're going to have a heavy illo, arrange for your illo to be towards the bottom, of the silkscreen, because the ink tends to be forced there by the repeated action of the roller.
It's often a good idea if you're going to have black. If you want black on the top of the page, lay out the stencil upside down.
Upside down.
It's easy.
Yeah, okay. One point. Whatever you do. When you have problems, be as ingenious as you possibly can. If you can come up with a new technique, you can benefit everybody.
As you can see from this discussion,
we do quite a lot.
We do everything up to and including toilet paper with core flu on it to repair stencils that we've ripped
down there about, you know, using a separate stencil for your e-stencil LO, and then somebody says it's expensive in stencils.
It's a
much simpler method that'll work. Get waxed paper and old stencil, chop off the heading, glue it up together. There you go.
I usually use cheap stencils to insert illos if I'm running on two
wheels. I find it easy enough to...
O'Brien!
Backing off to the wonderful matter of layout, I only ran off one fanzine, but I came up with a technique that worked, and I'd like to pass it on for what it's worth for those who think they can handle it.
we wanted to know where things were going to go in the fanzine. So, you know, what was the left and what was the right-hand page and all that. And what some people do is type up the fanzine in dummy, okay, so you know where everything is. I decided I didn't want to do that, especially since the fanzine was 64 pages long.
Right.
Yes.
So what I did was, we had two typewriters. One was Pica, one was Elite. We took every manuscript from every author and ran them through the typewriters and measured line counts against the platen bar that has little numbers on it. And we typed up our editorials first and did line counts on the stencil so we knew what fit on a stencil. And then we laid out the entire fanzine in numbers, mathematically, on paper, uh-huh. using statistics.
Great. Yeah.
The fact that articles end and a new article starts a new page takes care of any slob for any reasonably
right.
length article. And we found
right.
that we had very little error even after our 10-page monster article. So that it's
that's
possible to figure out just where things
good.
Are going without typing a thing.
Difficult and intricate, but very, very
of
good.
Of course, you may have a format where you don't want to start articles in the middle of the page.
We were able to take
no,
care of
page.
Pictures, too.
Yeah.
So what you're talking about is applying copy fitting from professional
printing. Okay, we're just going to have a couple more brief questions here.
I have one that's even simpler, but maybe the fact that it's not complex enough would be enough to put something off from it. We simply decided that the beginning page of each article or story would start on a right-hand page. And we typed our stencils with that in mind. Page one is a right-hand page, page two is a left-hand page, so forth. We did not put page numbers on it until we got the whole thing put
mm-hmm.
on a stencil.
Yeah,
then we put it together in the order that we wanted it to appear in the magazine. Many times, one article would end just right for the next one to begin. If we had a blank page or a partial page, we filled it with a piece of poetry, an ad, a piece of artwork.
Yeah.
Then
yeah.
you put your page numbers on when you've got it all put together.
That's why
on
reason and knowledge
that works as long as the order is of no importance.
I think any of these
well,
methods.
You don't understand what I mean. You can put it in your own order.
No, I mean, as long as it doesn't matter what article appears before another.
No, I say you can
it
put
works.
It in
yeah.
whatever order you want.
Yeah, except that you may get stuck with a piece of poetry being the only thing that fits it after a certain article, and you really wanted to put it somewhere else.
Well, in that case,
but
you scrounge around
filler.
For filler.
Yeah. Since it gets can get monotonous to have everything starting on the right-hand page, I use an even less complex and much lazier method, which is just to estimate and lay out as I go along. When I get to a page, I'll say, it's
do
be really good to have a nice yellow up there in the left, and I put it
there. When you do things like lots of apposites, which it really doesn't matter, how perfectionist you get. You get very, very used to doing this sort of thing, just winging it.
All these things
you
are...
You can go home with your jetty dynamite just by doing it as you go along. I've always first drafted everything on stencil. What
I do it that way, but
graphics.
I usually know how long everything's going to be roughly, and I have an idea
all these things are techniques that you have to kind of you get to after you've had a lot of experience, and you learn by experience. Now, does anybody else have a... fantastically important question. Okay, we're going to break this off now. And remember, there is a party tonight, so maybe you can find some of these fans and ask them about their techniques if you've got further questions.
Linda,
where's the room?
I'll get you on the list.
Off the main lobby.
We'll find out what's what. Somebody from Jackson, Mississippi just gave me his address, and I think they've got one in his hometown, so he's in luck.
I know what they're there.